You're watching MS World, and I'm Dr. Daniel Kantor, Chief Medical Correspondent, joined here in a special question-answer session for you at home by Dr. Sam Hunter, Dr. Jack Burks, and Dr. Ed Fox. Often in MS, we talk about disease-modifying therapies, and we talk about preventing something in the future. That's sometimes a hard concept to get, that idea that we're giving you something now to have an effect in the future. We also want to think about what can we do to make people better. And sometimes people ask about what can we do about remyelinating. If one of the issues in MS is the loss of myelin or demyelination, can we do anything to remyelinate? And then another question that comes up a lot has to do with stem cells. Where are we with stem cells, and how long is it going to take before we see stem cells? And then a special question for you, Dr. Hunter, is should people just travel across the world and get stem cells even before we have research that supports it? So starting this out, what do we know about remyelination, Dr. Fox?
We know that remyelination is possible. And that's something that I'm not certain that every person with MS has actually heard from a doctor. That in animal models, that we have been able to prove that this does in fact occur. And that in the human as well, there is an attempt to be able to heal from a lesion. And so knowing this is possible, all research is to promote this. If we understood a lot of the details about the activation of genes and other things that would allow this, I think we would have much more directed therapies already. But we don't. It's an ongoing process. So this is where we're having to have a merging of the basic science and the applied science, the scientific gain we get from learning about pharmaceuticals. And so although we have, I think, ample data of the medicines that exist right now, we're getting more data and we're looking further for stem cells or factors that could be given to somebody to promote new myelin growth. And what that takes is activating the cell that makes myelin. If you make that cell more active, more productive, you might have more healing.
Dr. Hunter, tell me about one of these issues in remyelination. It's something called RHIGM22. Can you tell us a little bit more about it?
Well, RHIGM22 is a drug that's been in development for over 20 years. It was developed from a laboratory in Mayo Clinic. I used to work with them, and it is an excellent agent for repairing the nervous system in mice. And it is related to many of the antibodies that normally circulate in our body. It's a genetically programmed antibody that came out of a patient with a cancer. And it's been tested in mice, and it makes really sick mice with an MS-like illness jump up and run around within a couple of weeks after a single dose. Now, it's been through safety testing in the United States. It's safe. We have no idea whether it's going to work or not. They're going to start for it. And there's another agent that's related that's being developed by another company that works in a different way, a more precise way. How these agents should even be tested is a matter of debate, because we don't know who will respond and who won't respond to them. Obviously, you have to still have the connections. You still have to have the cells that can repair the myelin. We think in many cases those are there, because we know that this already happens. We know repair happens when we control inflammation, and it happens much more in our current age than it did before we had our current drugs. And not only with really aggressive drugs, but it happens with medicines like interferon beta and glutaminoacetate. They can see this on MRI techniques. We know that it happens a lot in younger people, that younger people have a tremendous capacity for repair. But lesions that are repeatedly injured and are large or highly inflammatory are the ones where this repair fails. And there's good experimental evidence that the cells that damage the brain are the same ones that prevent the repair. And this is from many animal models. But there is an opportunity to be realized here. And there's actually data from MRI imaging and from the electrodiagnostic tests that are done to show some of our medicines improve the function of these pathways in the nervous system in a way that looks like the myelin is being repaired.
Dr. Burks, you see people from all over the world. Some of these people must go to clinics that offer stem cell research. What do you tell patients when they say, I'm going to a place, I'm going to spend a large sum of money, I'm going to get stem cells for my multiple sclerosis?
Well, first of all, I say it's exciting times. The research is very exciting. There are now drugs that are in clinical trials right now that may stimulate remyelination. I think stem cells are very exciting potentially, and I have major concerns. And so I discourage patients from going into commercial settings to have this done. There are experimental settings that I think are well controlled and we may learn something from, but I'm very concerned that people don't know what cells to use in these clinics. They don't know what dose. They don't know how to give them. Some people are giving it into the brain. Some people are giving it to the spinal cord. Some people are giving it in different ways. It's just not ready for prime time. And I have had enough issues with my patients who have done this where they've gotten terrible infections and actually died. This is not ready. This is an experimental therapy that we should be excited about. We should wish them well, but this is not a commercially available, viable option, in my opinion.
Well, I want to thank the three of you for really delving in deeply into remyelination as well as stem cell research. Earlier this week, we had the opportunity also to talk to Dr. Mark Freeman, who was actually giving one of the Meet the Professor dinners about stem cell research. And his advice to all of us at MS World was, while this is exciting times, right now is not yet the time to start going ahead and going to places where people might get infusions of we're not sure what. There's not quality control, and we can't make sure that your safety is obtained. If you do, however, make any decision to do any sort of experimental or other types of therapy, make sure to tell your neurologist you're doing it. Just because you think your neurologist is not going to be happy with decisions you make doesn't mean you shouldn't let them know for your own safety about what's going on. I want to thank the three of you, and I want to thank you for joining us at home.